Hey, while the shelter in place has been really, really rough, but to add to our problems, we're entering into storm season. When we come back, if you thought it was bad just being stuck in the house, imagine being stuck in the house with no lights. When we come back, I'm going to introduce you to my main man, Ryan Stowe from DTE Energy. We're going to talk about how DTE is protecting us. We'll be right back with Detroit Wants to Know. Good morning. Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. Today, we're talking to Ryan Stowe of DTE Energy. He's the man that makes sure our lights are on all the time. Ryan Stowe, how are you doing with that social distancing out there?
We're doing our best. It makes it hard to do electrical work out there in the field, but our teams are adapting well.
So with the social distancing and the shelter in place, what are you doing to protect the frontline workers? Let's start there.
Right. One of the first things we did at the beginning of the pandemic when this was all starting to roll out is we took a pause in the work that we're doing. So we tried to limit it to just the important critical work out there. So we know how important it is for people to have their lights, especially in a time like this. So we were really focused on just dealing with outages and other hazards that might pop up out there in the public. So to make sure that, you know, we can keep the public safe as well as our employees safe. Since then, we've put in a number of other practices trying to keep that social distancing with our crews. So we've put in other measures like wearing face masks and gloves and extra cleaning procedures, and even things like just keeping one person per vehicle. So where you might see a crew that would typically show up with maybe two trucks or something like that, now you might see four or five trucks show up.
Because
we've
have
just one person.
One person per truck. That's why.
That's right.
Okay. Yep. Where do you get all those trucks from? I just got to know.
Well, we kind of did some begging and borrowing internally. So we were borrowing from other groups that weren't, whose work wasn't going in the same way that it was before. So we wanted to repurpose some of those. We've also went out and just got some rentals to help tide us over while we're in this environment.
May and June are usually heavy storm months around here. I mean, it starts in late April, but May and June, it can get really hairy in Detroit, in Michigan as a whole.
That's right.
How are you going to ask for help from other states if you've got one person per truck? Because I know Ohio's going to be doing the same thing, right?
That's right. So I think first we wanted to make sure our folks could stay safe, could do their work in a safe fashion. We think we've got that well set up now. So we're able to deal with just in the last couple weeks, a couple kind of wind events that have come through, and we've been able to get everybody restored in a timely fashion. So then we've also been working with the mutual aid groups that all of the utilities partner with and work through, to make sure that we're all on the same page with the protocols that we would use. So where we would house those workers, how we do temperature and health checks for them, how we make sure that they're getting, you know, food and things like that. So all the logistics end up front. I think once we prove that out, that we can help keep those out-of-state workers safe, then they're more willing to come and help us in a time of need. So in the utility industry, we know everybody is in the same situation, and so we want to help if they need our help, and vice versa.
Okay, what about your subcontractors in Detroit? Are you forcing them to behave the same way DTE does or not? Because you have a lot of different line companies that work for you.
That's right. We do depend on our partners and our contract partners quite a bit. And so we've asked them to adopt the same practices. So they're trying to follow the same social distancing with one person per vehicle, wearing masks and other protection. Sometimes with the current masks we have, there is a risk of electrical flash. So when you're working close to electrical equipment, there's certain clothing and PPE that you can wear and you can't wear. Right now, those masks need to be taken off when you're up close to the electrical equipment. Luckily, we've been working with industry partners and suppliers. We've gotten the first sets of masks in the country that are rated for arc flash protection. So they're going to be able to start wearing those masks now, even when they're up doing the most critical work by the electrical equipment.
Okay. Ryan Stowe, we're almost at an end. Is there anything you want to leave us with?
Well, DTE, we know the criticalness of the electric service for everybody, and we're really prepared to help deal with any situations that might come up. Our employees are ready to step up to the challenge should or when we have any additional storms. We're going to do our best, and we're going to try to keep everybody's lights on.
Okay. Ryan Stowe from DTE Energy, I want to thank you very much for joining us. Ladies and gentlemen, when we come back, we're going to have the Chief Judge of the Eastern District of Michigan of the United States District Court. My sister-in-law, Judge Denise Pagehood, joins us next. We'll be right back.
Even in the face of the pandemic, we want to assure you, DTE is here to serve. Our dedicated crews are working 24/7 to provide the safe, reliable energy everyone in Michigan depends on, especially now. We're thankful for the strength and resilience of each of our employees and all of our neighbors across the state. Remember, we're Michiganders. We're tough. We'll power through. DTE.
It's always been a dream of mine coaching my kids.
One, two, three.
But there are times I'd get back pain, dizziness, but I ignored it. I'm young, I'm healthy. I was wrong. I had a heart attack right in front of my wife and kids. Thank God for my wife, Leslie. She got me to DMC here on Valley Sinai. Their team saved my life, and their cardiac rehab program got me back to normal, coaching our newest member. DMC here on Valley Sinai gave me a second shot. I'm forever grateful.
Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. That was a rousing first segment we had with DTE. I feel that we're going to be covered during this outbreak with their storm service. I think we're going to be all right. They're going to minimize outages and pull people from other states. I now have the Chief Judge of the Eastern District of the U.S. District Court with me, my sister-in-law, Denise Page Hood. Judge Hood, tell us, how is the court functioning in this time of a pandemic?
Well, first, Steve, let me thank you for inviting me to be on your show. I really appreciate the opportunity to be on your program. We are functioning. That's one thing I can say. We have are not in our usual mode, but hardly anybody is in their usual mode at this time. Our courthouse is closed to the public at this time. Employees may come in. They're all working remotely from home. I have a great staff. They're doing a great job of making sure that people's rights are protected during this time. So everyone's working remotely. We are doing all of our detention hearings, initial appearances, arraignments, revocation, probation, and pretrial release. We're doing them remotely. We're using a Zoom platform for many of them. We're using our own video conferencing platform. We are, in this particular instance, people are appearing from the jails. If they're a defendant being held in one of the jails where we house people, they can also appear from the detention center in Milan, Michigan, where there's a federal detention center. And then people who are just recently arrested can be brought to one of our divisional courthouses where we have the defendant appear in a courtroom along with the marshals. And everyone else appears remotely, the judge from their home, the staff people from their homes, the court reporter from their home, the attorneys from either their homes or their offices. And those people can have their rights protected to be able to have an appearance before the court without waiting an extended period of time to be heard and either released or detained. So we're functioning that way. On the civil side, there are many things that people can do from their homes. You can do a settlement conference on video conference or teleconferencing. You can do your motions, many of them just on the briefs that are already prepared and presented to you. So there are a number of civil things that can go on. What can't go on is you can't have a civil trial right now. In fact, you can't have any kind of jury trial at this time. The other thing on the criminal side that we have been allowed to do is when the legislature, the Congress, passed the CARES Act, it had a provision for the judiciary to do a number of things by video conferencing and telephone conferencing that we had not been able to do before.
Time out. That's in the CARES Act itself?
That's in the CARES Act. If you're looking at it and you're familiar with it, it's on begins on something like page 668 or 666, and it has a whole section on the judiciary. And it allows us to hold those detention hearings, initial appearances, arraignments, where people are required to come to court if you're a defendant. It allows us to hold them by video conferencing or teleconferencing. It also allows us, upon certain findings by the chief judge and then by the individual judge of a case, to hold a plea hearing or a sentencing hearing also by video conferencing, and if it's not available, by telephone conferencing, as long as the defendant waives their right to appear in person before the judge. And so with a finding of the chief, which I found that there are circumstances that exist that jeopardize the health and safety of the public, I've made that finding, and now each judicial officer just has to make a finding that the ends of justice will not be met if the case is delayed. That means that it has to be the kind of case where the remedy is not just an adjournment. An example of that is we hear cases where people have been picked up on reentry, illegal reentry into the country. Many of those people have a guideline range of 0 to 6 months. Many times by the time they get to court, they've already been held for a month or two. And those are people that you want to be able to adjudicate and have out of our system and prepared for deportation as quickly as possible, rather than sitting in one of our jails where, you know, we know the virus is susceptible to people because they're housed much closer together than most of the rest of us.
When we come back, I'd like to delve a little bit deeper into the criminal side, if you don't mind, Your Honor. All right?
I don't.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back with Chief Judge Denise Page Hood of the Eastern District of Michigan.
Every success story starts with a spark of curiosity, of wanting more. Wayne County Community College District has more than 120 academic and career training programs and support to help you every step of the way. From registration to financial aid to career placement, find your spark and get on a path to your best life. Register today.
The census doesn't matter. I don't see the impact.
Actually, Michigan gets $3,000 per person per year for 10 years to help fund schools, community food assistance, Medicaid, and more.
All right, I'll do it.
I'm kind of worried about my privacy.
The census is for everyone, but your data is not. Your answers to 9 basic questions will not be shared.
All right, I'm going to do it.
Cool. Be counted today. Visit my2020census.gov.
Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. My guest this morning is Chief Judge Denise Page Hood of the Eastern District of Michigan. Judge, there are a lot of criminal cases that have been sitting in the pipeline, and they're just put on hold indefinitely?
Well, some of them are put on hold, Steve, and you know, you have criminal cases at different stages of the proceedings. If you're at an initial stage of the proceeding, you're being processed through to go forward through the whole criminal process. And you have a certain period of time that you have to appear before a judge or a magistrate judge to be detained or not. You might also be set for trial. If you're set for trial, we're not holding any jury trials. We're hard pressed to bring jurors in while there is a stay-at-home order and where there's social distancing, because you've been in a courtroom and you know people sit side by side. Right. So we're only doing things that are immediate and emergency. I don't want to say emergency. I want to say situations where the ends of justice will not be met unless we proceed. So, for instance, if you're being detained and you're going to enter a plea of guilty and the judge finds that the ends of justice will not be served if your case is delayed and the judge has to make that finding, then the judge can take that plea by video conference, or if a video conference ability is not available, they can do it by telephone conference if the defendant agrees. And then you can take the plea and proceed to sentencing. That means your sentencing might be immediate or it might be down the road, depending on what kind of case it is. And if it's down the road, you know, a month or two, or it might be okay for it to be delayed. You might be a person who could be released pending your sentencing. And that's particularly true in a plea where that might be the outcome, that you could be released and set free pending your sentencing. But a judge has to make a finding that it needs to be done to achieve the meaningful ends of justice, that the interests of justice will not be damaged by delay. Now, there's some people for whom that is not necessarily a big issue. We have, by administrative order, waived the speedy trial rights of defendants during this time. So, for instance, if you're charged with a crime and you're out on bond, it's likely that your trial is going to get delayed. And maybe the word delayed is not the right word, postponed. It's going to be adjourned till a time when you can come in and actually have a jury trial. And when that will be, we're not really sure, because we're not sure what's going to happen with this virus and when we will be in a position to tell people who are going to be jurors that they should come to court and hear a jury trial, where, you know, it's likely they would be required to sit a little bit closer together than we anticipate people would at this time. Yeah. But yes, you're right. Some people's jury trials are going to be postponed to a time in the future.
Okay, yeah. I mean, because you've done a miraculous job. One of the things that's unsung is that you've done a miraculous job with the jury selection, creating the jury pool.
We have better jury pools, I believe, anecdotally than we have in the past. We still, Steve, you know, I was on your show once before where we were encouraging people to come and be jurors. And that is because we have a low turnout rate of people responding to our jury summonses in the, you know, Tri-County area and particularly in the Detroit area. And so we still are going to have that problem, and that problem will become exacerbated when this is over, because people are still going to be a little bit afraid. They're going to be a little bit afraid of coming into our Detroit courthouse, where we know that in Detroit the rate of deaths is higher than in other places. They're going to be concerned about whether or not it's safe, even if the virus is just on the decline and not eradicated entirely. And so there are going to be a lot of reasons why people won't come. There's kids might still be out of school. They may have lost their job and just been recalled to their job, and the jury summons be a complication for them because they've been out of work. So we're going to be facing all of those kinds of things when we come back and we're ready to have a jury trial. For instance, there are about 27 jury trials set for May in the Eastern District of Michigan's Detroit location alone. And we know that some of those are cases that aren't going to go to trial. Some of them may plead guilty. Other things may happen to them. But that's a big number of trials. And that's a lot of jurors to call into court. So we're looking at how we're going to handle that once we're able to return to the places where we were.
Before we go to break, I've got to ask you this. So people can be too sick to be incarcerated, but the U.S. attorney, I haven't read anywhere where he's stopped work. They're still charging people. I mean, I'm just like, what happens?
Well, there's still crime, Steve. I think people still want people who commit crime to be arrested and charged. I would say they're still doing that, but the not maybe as many arrests as we had when we were just functioning in what we knew then to be normal circumstances. But, you know, they do respond to these motions also for release from detention. It's not just that you're too sick to be incarcerated, because there are many people who are sick and are incarcerated. It has to do with weighing all the other factors in addition to that, because that was something that might not have been weighed at the time that it may not have been a big issue that you had asthma at the time that you were originally detained, and that may now factor in. And of course, the government has the right to respond to that and say why it's not an issue, or why you're not more susceptible, or why the facility where you're being held is being kept up in a way that protects you by having hand sanitizer, more opportunities to wash your hands, more cleanliness overall, more separation of inmates and the like.
Okay. Your Honor, we got to take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to touch on the civil side. Ladies and gentlemen, you're watching Detroit Wants to Know. My guest is Denise Pagehood. We'll be right back. Chief Judge Denise Pagehood. We'll be right back.
This is an important message from the Wayne County Treasurer, Eric Sabree.
Currently, the Wayne County Treasurer's Office is closed to the public. This decision was made in order to mitigate the spread of the coronavirus. We are in total agreement with the governor's emergency declaration and the efforts of Wayne County leadership to protect the health and safety of our employees and the taxpayers who visit our office. Given the emergency declaration, we have suspended foreclosure activity for the 2020 calendar year. If you have delinquent taxes, they still must be paid. Taxpayers are encouraged to make tax payments by paying online at one of the 70 DivDat kiosks located throughout the county, through the U.S. Mail, or mobile app. For more information and updates, please visit the Wayne County Treasurer's website at treasurer.waynecounty.com or email us at taxinfo@waynecounty.com. We are all in this together. We don't know how long this emergency situation will last. I appreciate your patience and cooperation.
Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. My guest this morning is Chief Judge Denise Pagehood of the Eastern District, U.S. District Court. Judge, we've only got a little bit of time left because, like you are, you were just really voluminous on the criminal side. I don't know if you can cover the civil side, but for example, there's a suit brought against Governor Whitmer's stay-at-home order. With the court shut down, does that suit progress? How is that heard?
Yes, that suit can progress, but it has to progress, as I said, differently than it would when you would have a hearing and everyone would come into court and listen to the hearing. And that case, in one of its hearings, a temporary restraining order in one of those cases was heard by one of our judges, and it was heard over a video conferencing platform. And the way that the public could participate, including the media, was to register and be able to dial into it so that they could listen to, and I believe some of them see the proceedings. And a hearing was held. The judge was, I believe, in his home. The attorneys were wherever they desired to be on video conference, and a hearing could be held in that way. And we were testing that out because part of what we want to provide on the criminal side is the opportunity for there to be public access to the proceeding so that a defendant could, have their family listen in, or a victim could listen in, or the media could listen in if it was something that was of interest to the media. And so in that case, we allowed that participation, even though it was a civil case. And people were able to have public access to the proceedings. So there were some media people and some other people that were just interested that were able to participate as part of the public. So that kind of civil thing can go on. More than likely, your civil matters that are not high interest public matters are going to be heard by a telephone conference on a hearing. And that's because the judge can hear most of those kinds of motions without having the parties appear at all. The judge can always order that there's significant enough briefing that they could decide the motion without oral argument. That's what it's called. You hear it without oral argument, and they could decide the motion and issue a written opinion. And that would be sufficient in most civil cases. You're not going to be able to have your civil trial at this time, particularly a jury trial, but you could have a settlement conference now. So if a group wanted to have a settlement conference, they can contact the judge's office and say, we think we're ready to settle this case. Can we have a telephone conference, settlement conference? There will be an opportunity maybe at some point for there to be video conferencing of those, but the criminal matters take priority over that. So we'll be using the video conferencing as much as possible for the criminal matters as opposed to the civil matters. So your case won't stop. You can still have discovery that can be done without people appearing in person. We have a lot of video depositions that people regularly do, or telephone depositions. Most of the motions, as I said, can be handled without oral argument, or it can be over the telephone. So, you know, there's an opportunity for your civil case to come right up to being ready for trial. And so that's where we'll be on those civil cases. We'll just be waiting for the time that we could be back to having a courtroom trial with a jury. And that's going to be a little while yet.
Okay. Your Honor, we have to go. I could stay here all afternoon because, you know, there's so much peering into the future that I'm seeing here. This is like a sci-fi novel. Okay, you're talking about video everything.
Steve, I want you to know that all of the courts, not just the federal court, but the state courts, because we're using the state court county jail video conference platforms to help us arraign people and the like. But all of the court staff has been working really, really hard. They've never been this creative in their lives. They've never been as able to adjust to working from their homes. I mean, these are people who are used to coming into a building and working. And they're all working together and very good to make sure that people's constitutional rights are protected and that people will continue to have their day in court in some way. It may not look like the day in court that you used to have, but it will nonetheless be a day in court.
Okay, Your Honor, thank you for joining us today. Ladies and gentlemen, if you like high-quality local programming that you're seeing here, help us out. Cash App us, $ Steve Hood Show. That's Cash App us, $ Steve Hood Show. We need your help to keep interviews like this going. Have a great week. We're going to make it through this.
The preceding program was paid for by Ronin America, DMC, Wayne County Treasurer's Office, DTE, WCCCD, the Center for Functional Health, Kemp Funeral Home, Amada Senior Care, Dr. Shauna Diggs, and Mike's Fresh Market.